Last time, on the pretentious analysis of humble Nintendo game show. Okay, that's a really terrible title. PAHN. Panalysis! Yeah, let's go with that. Panalysis. Last time, on Panalysis, a self-centered, pretentious college student spends 15 minutes trying to convince you that he's smarter than you. He also talked about the symbolism of Zelda or something. And now, this.
Proceeding immediately onward with no creative segue or transition, let's talk about the symbolic adolescence of our hero, Link. Saria presents you with, okay, wait. Wait, wait. Okay, actually there is something that I kind of need to address now before I forget. A friend who watched the first video actually pointed something out to me about swords and their symbolism. That's right, kids, it's time to learn! Don't worry, this won't take long to explain, it's just a brief history lesson. Swords have always been a symbolic trope in all kinds of storytelling, and in some cases the symbolism is consistent no matter where you go. Pretty much everywhere, swords represent violence, a lack of peace, and are often associated with phallic imagery. And yes, that does mean that the swords represent male genitalia. Let's be mature about this, please. I hope that explains things. Now let's move on. In Japan, swords have historically always been seen as an extension of the self, something of a physical manifestation of the warrior's soul, whereas in most Western societies, weapons have always been seen as tools to enforce one's ideals, or to protect the lives of ourself or our loved ones. If you want a more literal interpretation of the Japanese belief, then you should take a look at the anime, Bleach. In this show, all the characters' weapons are just representations of their soul. So this brings us back to the accusation I threw at Mido in the last episode. When he says that you can't be a man without a sword, is he just referencing the popular Japanese perception of what a sword represents? No. He's a childish jerk-off. And I stand by that. Mido still thinks that a person's manhood relies solely on arbitrary symbols, and Mido himself acts very childish and self-centered, so the juxtaposition between him and Link is still there. However, both the Kokiri Sword and the Master Sword, Link's ultimate weapon, both represent Link's spiritual strength. You have to undergo a great personal trial to obtain these weapons, and it takes a lot of hard work on Link's part. And since the Master Sword seems to just be a tool used to protect Hyrule in Link's eyes, we can see some Western influence in the way the game treats these swords anyway. Sorry about the segue, people. We can get back to serious business now. Ollie, can you stop eating your ass? The people I work with. Saria gives you the gift of the Fairy Ocarina, the first musical instrument you get. Ocarinas are sort of important in this game, in case you didn't notice. I think it's kind of sweet that your childhood friend is the first one to give you the gift of music. This makes it clear how important music is to the emotional core of the game's characters. You'll be soothing crying infants, comforting the spirits of the dead, and saving entire kingdoms with the power of music as the game progresses. Then, when you go out to Hyrule Field, all of a sudden the sheer scope of the outside world becomes clear. You're already able to explore such a huge, interesting world, and oh god! You. I could make a whole video about you. You know what? Just no. You get out to Hyrule Field, and then you exit the forest, and no one talks to you. You just know where to go. Because the Deku Tree told you. You just know where to go. And no one gives you advice, and no one repeats themselves a million times, and I hate this owl! We need to talk about the owl. Now, the owl here, spurting advice on things that you already knew very well, it clearly represents people who underestimate your wisdom and intelligence and want to patronize you to no end, and... Who am I kidding? He's just really, really annoying. Honestly, there's nothing really to say about this guy. He's not even a character, and he's never explained. I just
hate him! That's his point. My hate, that is his meaning.
Sorry, just reliving some early trauma. Getting back to the actual symbolism, this is when we start Link's adolescence. I'm aware it seems like it's very early to get into that phase, because, you know, he's still visually a kid, but this is in fact when Link starts to actually grow up and accept some more responsibility and broaden his horizons, so to speak.
Link journeys across Hyrule Field, and already you have quite a bit of territory to explore, and there's also a giant floating pineapple monster of doom that will kill you with its razor-sharp leaves. Nintendo, what do you smoke?
But your main goal is Hyrule Castle Town, a huge bustling city that certainly dwarfs the humble Kokiri Village by comparison. It's like the New York of Hyrule, only there's less culture, and less homeless people, and the music isn't as good, and there aren't any street performers, and there's no ethnic diversity, and everyone is straight, which leads me to believe it's not a very open-minded city. What was I talking about again? Right after that, it's time to journey forward and to know the So anyway, you have to sneak past the guards in order to see Princess Zelda, as the Deku Tree instructed you. The guards don't seem willing to trust a random 12-year-old boy in a grass skirt when he says that he's the chosen hero. Weird. After that, Link enters the castle through a waterway by throwing the castle's food supply in the moat. Way to play hero, bro. He then sneaks past some more incompetent guards to meet our titular heroine, Princess Zelda. In a lot of games and stories in general, a princess is seen as someone to save, and nothing more. Even in Miyamoto's other flagship franchise, Mario, princesses are usually just a goal. But this character is, well, different to say the least. Now, believe it or not, there are a lot of feminist undertones in this game and the Zelda games to follow, which is pretty progressive for a time when most important roles in games were played by manly men doing manly man things that only men could do because they were male. Zelda might seem like a typical princess at the moment, but let's just say Link's definitely not the only character that does some growing in this story. Zelda is surprisingly comfortable with the presence of a stranger in her garden and proceeds to tell you more about the legendary relic, the Triforce. The Deku Tree already talked about this briefly, but I kinda skipped over it for time. Sorry about that. Anyway, Zelda tells you that three goddesses of Hyrule long ago created the land by combining their various powers and virtues. There was, of course, a goddess of courage, a goddess of wisdom, and a goddess of power. After creating the world, the goddesses fuse their strength together to form the Triforce, a legendary treasure that can grant the wish of anyone who can enter the sacred realm and claim it. The person can wish for anything from peace to war, eternal life, or global domination. Ah, the Triforce. What a cavalcade of symbolism you are. I think that now's the perfect time to actually establish some of that symbolism.
Look at me, Internet. I have a basic knowledge of Photoshop.
Now, the Triforce is able to grant any wish that a person desires. I think it's crucial to remember that this artifact is comprised of three main parts: wisdom, courage, and power. These are things that humanity uses to accomplish its goals, of course. It's important to note that courage and wisdom are on the bottom layer, almost as if they're supporting power, the top piece. To me, this represents that power without any direction, intelligence, or virtue is meaningless. You can't have power for the sake of power, or else you're just going to head down a path of destruction and madness. Of course, in Ocarina of Time, we have Zelda, who represents wisdom, and Link, who represents courage. These two are the moral center of the story. Now, if only we had a third character to represent the destructive nature of power without a purpose. I wonder if he's the villain. This blatantly evil gentleman is none other than Ganondorf, leader of the desert tribe, the Gerudo. Zelda believes he is feigning loyalty to the king so he can gain more power. Ganondorf wants to obtain the Triforce and use its power to lay claim to the Kingdom of Hyrule. His motivations become a bit more clear and perhaps even sympathetic later on in the series, but by the time this game begins, he abandoned any good intentions long ago. He wants power because he wants power, and he's tired of being the leader of a neglected and isolated culture. He's here to take charge, and Link and Zelda are the only ones aware of his true intentions. After all that groovy stuff, Zelda gives you a letter representing your alliance with the royal family. Link needs to travel to Death Mountain to get the Goron Ruby, a symbol of power, and then travel to Zora's domain to obtain the Zora's Sapphire, a symbol of wisdom. These act as keys to unlock the sacred realm, and Link kinda needs to get there before Ganon does for obvious reasons. As you're about to depart, you meet Impa, Zelda's bodyguard. She teaches you one of the first melodies in the game, Zelda's Lullaby, which will be used throughout the game to prove your connection to the royal family whenever Zelda's handwritten letter isn't enough to prove that, apparently. You use this music to gain access to both the Goron City and the Zora's Domain. Using music to unite different cultures has a very powerful message behind it, and that theme will be taken to even a greater extent in the game's sequel, Majora's Mask. But that's a story for a later date.
Impa then gets you pointed in the right direction, demonstrates some ninja skills, and I end this video because it's already over 10 minutes long.
You know, the hardest thing about any of these videos is figuring out how to end it creatively, so... Here's a really cute puppy, yay!
Bye.